Welcome to Torah in 10. Today we're going to discuss some of the Rebbe's views on the thought of Sigmund Freud. Now, Freud was not a religious man. In fact, he rejected the idea of a monotheistic God, claiming that it was useful for the early parts of civilization to tame man from violence, but it really is now redundant. He thought that it's a kind of childish thing to rely on God. It's a basic emotional need for a father type of figure. So obviously Freud is not someone who's quoted in religious circles, in Torah circles. But one of the fascinating dimensions of the Rebbe's thought is because the Rebbe was so knowledgeable in many fields, he could often see the overlap between certain strands of secular thought and Torah thought. We're going to read part of a letter which was written in 1965, which the Rebbe wrote to, we don't know the name of the person, was not published, but he was a doctor of some description. And in it, he discusses one area of Jewish thought, quoting a passage from the Rambam, from Maimonides, which seems to parallel some of Freud's idea. Before we look at the letter, just a couple of words, a brief introduction. One of the popular ideas which has come out of Freudian thought is the idea of the subconscious. Freud actually didn't call it the subconscious, he called it the unconscious. He believed there's a layer of the mind, which we don't have immediate access to, where certain feelings, ideas are repressed, they are stored below the conscious layer, and they can come out in certain circumstances, such as meditation, random association, dream analysis, and of course verbal slips, the famous Freudian slip. And the Rebbe is going to say in a letter that this is actually a Torah true concept, and he's going to quote a passage from Maimonides which seems to be saying exactly the same thing. He then at the end rejects the idea, the Freudian idea of libido. Freud believed that there's a life drive. Libido means a survival propagation, the desire for other physical pleasures. That was at the core of man. And it's a very animalistic view of man, and Torah has a more optimistic view that there is goodness, there is neshama, there's soul at the core of all of us. So let's take a look now. The letter was actually written in English. I'm going to pop it up on the screen. It's written to a doctor in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And we're going to begin at the passage saying, "You ask me. You ask me about my reference to Rambam and where it contains in substance, though in different terms, the concepts of the conscience and subconscious of modern psychology. I had in mind a passage in Hilchos Gerushin, that means the laws of divorce, end of chapter 2. In the Rambam's magnum opus, Yad HaChazaka, the gist of that passage is as follows. There are certain matters in Jewish law, the performance of which requires free volition, not coercion. However, where the Jewish law requires special performance, it is permitted to use coercive measures until the reluctant party declares, 'I am willing,' and his performance is valid and considered voluntary." Now this is talking about a case where a man is required to give a get, a divorce document, by Jewish law, for whatever reason, and the court of law has ruled that he must give this, but for whatever reason he's being difficult, he's refusing to give it. So Rambam interestingly writes that pressure, coercion can be applied on this person to give the divorce document. Now the obvious question is that all mitzvahs of the Torah, and giving a divorce document is a biblical law, all laws of the Torah have to be done willingly. They can't be done under compulsion. And that's true of all spirituality. Spirituality and coercion are contradictory. Something has to come from within to be genuine, to be authentic. And what is the point of religion if it's not authentic? So we have a halachic, a legal problem here, that he's being coerced, and yet the divorce document has to be given willingly. However, where the Jewish law requires specific performance, it is permitted to use coercive measures until the reluctant party declares, "I am willing," and his performance is valid and considered voluntary. There seems here an obvious contradiction. If it is permitted to compel performance, why is it necessary that the person should declare himself willing? And if compulsory performance is not valid, what good is it if the person declares himself willing under compulsion, if it's not sincere? And here comes the essential point of the Rambam's explanation. Every Jew, regardless of his status and station, is essentially willing to do all that he is commanded to by our Torah. However, sometimes the Yetzer Hara prevails over his better judgment and prevents him from doing what he has to do in accordance with the Torah. When, therefore, Beis Din, the court of law, compels a Jew to do something, it is not with a view to creating in him a new desire, but rather to release him from the compulsion which had paralyzed his desire, thus enabling him to express his true self. Under these circumstances, when he declares, "I am willing," it is an authentic declaration. So it's a very interesting dynamic going on here. And obviously we never condone compulsion. Jewish law never condones violence or any sort of compulsion in any circumstances. This is an absolute exception, but it's bringing to light a very important point. That we believe that below the conscious layer of the Jew, there is a layer of spirituality. There is neshama, there's soul. And that draws us towards truth. It draws us towards goodness. And the only empirical way we have of determining ultimate reality, ultimate truth, is through the revealed system of the Bible, of the Torah, of the rabbinic law. And so when we have something which is a revealed truth, and a person's resisting, we know that deep down there is a yearning, there is a desire to be attracted towards that. And therefore the compulsion, which used in this particular circumstance, is not convincing that person to do something they didn't want to do. It's actually revealing in them their inner desire to do the right thing. Now let's carry on. To put the above in contemporary terminology, the conscious state of a Jew can be affected by external pressures that induce states of mind and even behavior which is contrary to his subconscious, which is the Jew's essential nature. When the external pressures are removed, it does not constitute a change or transformation of his essential nature, but on the contrary, is merely the reassertion of his innate and true character. And this, of course, was a cornerstone in the Rebbe's worldview, which informed all the shluchas activities, all the activities of outreach. Every outreach shliach professional knows in the back of his mind that a Jew has a soul, and that residing, however distant a person might be in terms of observance in their own beliefs, there's a kernel of faith there. And it only needs the right conditions, the right circumstances, a bit of love, a bit of warmth, the right activities, the right ideas, to bring that out from the subconscious layer and engender a warmer, more committed approach to Judaism. Now, having reached this far, you might think, well, Judaism's in favor of all Freud's theories, so there's a kind of warning at the end. To a person of our background, it is unnecessary to point out that nothing in the above can be construed as a confirmation of other aspects of the Freudian theory, to the effect that man's psyche is primarily governed by libido, the sex drive, etc., for these ideas are contrary to those of the Torah, whose view is that the human being is essentially good, as in the Rambam above. The only similarity is in the general idea that human nature is a composite of a substratum and various layers, especially in so far as the Jew is concerned, as above. And there's a very powerful, beautiful message here. And that is not that we should be coercing people. Scratch that. The message is that there's tremendous treasure houses of faith. There's a tremendous warmth, tremendous inner peace waiting to burst out from that subconscious layer. Freud believed that we can access it through dreams and other techniques. But the Jewish approach is that through observance, a simple act of Jewish ritual, a mitzvah, might seem that we're just commemorating a past event, might seem something symbolic, but Hasidic wisdom, Kabbalistic wisdom, always understood that we're drawing out the subconscious. We have an attachment to it, and by manifesting that attachment in actual deed, we're actually bringing to light the psyche, the deeper substratum of psychological energy and drive, which is driving all our activities, and we're becoming more true to ourselves. So there's tremendous power in this idea. I hope you found it interesting. Please join us next week again for Torah in 10.